All right, everybody, hello and welcome to another episode of The Nostalgia Trap. I am your host, David Parsons. Very excited to bring you this interview with my guest, Daniel Pinchbeck, today. Daniel Pinchbeck is the author of many books over the years, and his work has meant a lot to me, especially, I think, in my early 20s, around 9/11 and all that, George W. Bush, the Iraq War. His work really kind of gave a weight to the history we were going through and kind of suggested really tremendous things, and I think in many ways set me on the path of, you know, heading towards being a weird leftist. And by weird leftist, I mean a left person that thinks about UFOs and psychedelics and Mayan prophecies and all kinds of shit like that. So, you know, Pinchbeck is interesting because in the years since his work really, I think, exploded onto the scene in the early 2000s, talking about all this stuff, you know, we've seen the rise of this kind of like intellectual dark web with, like, you know, all those assholes, Jordan Peterson, Sam Harris, et cetera, who are kind of presenting this kind of alternate vision of what reality might be. And a lot of it is like, you know, around Carl Jung, and like kind of, I think Daniel would agree that they're kind of misappropriating Jung's work. In either case, Daniel Pinchbeck is not one of those people. He's not an intellectual dark web douchebag. He's someone who I think has a really earnest and I think humanistic engagement with these issues. And I wanted to bring him on to talk about specifically UFOs. UFOs are in the news, and it's not just like the Blink-182 guy that's talking about them. UFOs are, there's been articles in the last year and a half in the Washington Post, in the New York Times, in Vanity Fair, a number of other publications that are talking about the U.S. government's recent engagement with crafts, unidentified flying crafts. Specifically, you know, I think there's one that was floating over Virginia Beach for 11 days in the summer of 2017. The U.S. Navy observed it. It was described as a sphere encased in a cube, but it seemed to shapeshift. It seemed to move in ways that defied all physical law. And, you know, there's also stories about the U.S. government being in possession of technology from recovered from alien craft. They don't say where it's from. But these metals that they're in possession of are in Las Vegas somewhere, and that the people who have handled them have experienced, quote unquote, physiological changes. So I don't know what to do with any of that shit. Like, I honestly don't. And I don't know, you know, if it's misinformation, you know, how far this rabbit hole goes. But Daniel Pinchbeck is someone who's been thinking about these issues for many, many years. I mean, he has books that, trying to kind of take apart the phenomenon of UFOs, aliens, crop circles, psychedelic drugs. And he has an intense and compelling series of takes on what's happening. I mean, if I gave you his main thesis, I think that is kind of underlying all of his work for the last at least 20 years. And you can check out all of his books. 2003, Breaking Open the Head is the one that really kind of drew me into his take on things. But if he had one kind of, I think, overarching thesis, it's that the climate change and the climate crisis is forcing humanity to go through some sort of weird initiation ritual. In other words, it's an opportunity for human beings to learn a series of important lessons and evolve to a higher state of consciousness. So there's all sorts of tendrils to that theory and all sorts of different ideas embedded in it. So I'll let Daniel kind of talk about it and explain it in this episode. This week, there's more Daniel Pinchbeck content. I have a bookshelf episode up. If you're a subscriber to The Nostalgia Trap, you can go listen to me talking about that first book, 2003's Breaking Open the Head, which is a really great history of all these different types of engagements with psychedelic drugs and kind of shamanistic worldviews, and kind of, again, doesn't really pack it into this really kind of ugly intellectual dark web shit, but instead gives it a real, I would argue, like pro-human and anti-capitalist take that will resonate with a lot of the people who like the stuff we talk about on The Nostalgia Trap. So, you know, how we pack in all these weird ideas into a larger kind of idea of what the left is, I don't know. I don't know how that works. But I wanted to bring Daniel on to explore some of these ideas. So I hope you like it. And again, if you're a subscriber to the show, there's more content up on the Patreon right now. You can go check out. And if you want to become a subscriber and help us begin and expanding our operations here, and continue bringing you this content, go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. Thanks so much for all that are doing that. I hope you enjoy this episode. Here's me talking with Daniel Pinchbeck. Daniel Pinchbeck, thank you so much for joining me. You sent me an email last week that I absolutely loved opening. The subject line, I think, would be a great way for us to start. The subject line was, is there a hyper-dimensional occult control system? And I think a lot of the people who listen to the show will be like, what do you mean by that? So maybe we can start there. I know that's kind of a big question, but you're working on, or you're about to put out a little book, a quick book about UFOs and about the UFO phenomenon that's accelerating, I think, right now. But I wonder what you could give us to give us a little hint about what that book might be taking on.
Yeah, well, the book is out already. I mean, it's it was my first experiment with just like wanting to, you know, write something quickly and then self-publish it.
Cool.
So it's out as a Kindle and a print on demand and a Dare to. And yeah, it's called The Occult Control System. And many years ago, over a decade ago, I wrote a book called 2012, The Return of Quetzalcoatl. Mm-hmm. That was looking at a range of phenomena, including prophecies of different indigenous cultures like the Hopi and the Maya in Mexico. And as part of the research for that book, it was sort of a tangent, but it totally connected. I studied the crop circles that appear in fields around the world, but most intensively in the UK and England. And I ended up spending a whole summer there in 2002 and visiting different crop circles as soon as they popped up, and studying the phenomenon and talking to all these different characters involved with it, including physicists who were researching the phenomenon, and the geometers who were studying the patterns. Also, people who claimed to be hoaxers who claimed that they were the humans responsible for the patterns. And yeah, I ended up finding it a really, really fascinating investigation. And I think I probably wrote about 100 pages around it in the book.
Yeah, the crop circle thing was an intense part of that book. And I remember thinking then that I really liked the way you were treating it, because you were treating it as a kind of complicated phenomenon that didn't have one single answer.
Yeah, exactly. And that phenomenon, and some of the crop circles that appeared, I mean, some of them related directly to kind of Mayan mythology and the Mayan calendar dates and so on. But some of them also directly related to kind of this sort of saga of like the alien abductions and the gray aliens and so on. So then that led me into a whole investigation of that phenomena. And yeah, I've been kind of waiting to go back into that. And recently there have been so many kind of astonishing articles in the mainstream, like the New York Times, the Washington Post, and Vanity Fair. And it basically seems that we are in some kind of process of what's called disclosure, where this realization that there are these inexplicable crafts and you know, military pilots are encountering, you know, totally bizarre phenomena, like you know, that I talk about in that essay.
It's kind of like amazing that these articles came out, and you know, a lot of people, I think, don't have a way to integrate them, you know, these ideas. So they just kind of pass through the culture. And it's incredible because, yeah, some of the things that are mentioned are like, I mean, there are lots of details, but I'll just mention one, which is like a cube or a sphere floating in a cube.
Exactly.
Yeah. And just absolutely incredible stuff that, again, is stuff that the U.S. government is documenting. And I think there was one that was kind of docked off of Virginia Beach for like 11 hours or something. And these things defy all physical laws that we know.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, I was aware when I wrote the 2012 book in 2006 that this, you know, was a very significant scenario. And, you know, also the alien abductions, which have been like, you know, reported by thousands and thousands of people, with many books coming out and people around the world reporting similar experiences and so on, that this really required, yeah, more cultural focus. And yeah, as you said, the problem is that it's like literally extremely difficult to fit it into any of the, you know, kind of current cultural narratives or containers that we have. We don't have any story that really, you know, allows for these sort of hyperdimensional experiences, these kind of liminal experiences and so on. And so I felt it was, you know, valuable to go back into it and try to analyze it and explore it and look at it from different angles and so on.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird because we do have like a culture, you know, in terms of like movies and TVs, that's kind of obsessed with this stuff in some ways. But on the other hand, I wonder what, because you've written a little bit about that in terms of like the intersection of, I don't know, there's a psychological dimension to this. I know that Carl Jung wrote about this, and I'm forgetting exactly what his thesis was, but it was a lot of it was about like kind of UFOs as projections coming out of the human mind, and especially associated with the advent of the nuclear bomb and all the kind of awful industrial technology that created world wars in the 20th century. I don't know if I think a lot about history. I think a lot about, and I know you do too. And I think that connection to like where we're at in terms of our historical moment, it's hard to miss the, like, I don't know, the Trump moment happening at the same time that the UFO thing is happening. Do you think there's any connection to our kind of like, I don't know, our human crisis and our the alien thing?
Yeah, I mean, I do. I guess that's why I think it's so important to explore. But it's also, as I said, it's difficult to explore and because it's not like a scientific exploration where you can say, oh, like if you know it's 2.3 degrees of gravity or whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the ways that I discussed it in the book, well, yeah, I do talk about Carl Jung. His last book was called The Flying Saucer Myth.
Was that really his last book? I didn't realize that.
Yeah. And he, he was doing all this work on, you know, dream analysis for many years. And he found that in dreams, people often encountered this round object that they would kind of approach, that would sort of have this like spiraling kind of movement. It would recede and move closer. And he really found it to be an image of psychic wholeness. Mm. And he actually believed that we were in, you know, approaching, you know, the sort of psychological event of, you know, what Judeo-Christians call the apocalypse, a word that means revealing or unveiling.
Yeah.
So it's like a time when everything that was hidden becomes known, and also a time when the the consciousness has grown to the point where we can kind of integrate the shadow and the unconscious aspects of the psyche. Mm. So for him, the flying saucer in its round shape and in the way it like appeared and disappeared and, you know, moved through the edges of the consciousness was a kind of image of psychic wholeness. I think that
that's such an incredible idea.
Yeah. One definition of the apocalypse for Jungians is the coming of the self into conscious realization. So as a result of this kind of unveiling and revealing, and I think on some level we seem to be moving more into a kind of like psychic or dreamlike reality on a very subtle level, and even, you know, manifestations like Trump seem to be part of this process. I mean, where it's almost like reality is becoming like this incredibly bizarre caricature or cartoon.
Yes.
And Trump himself grew up with, Norman Joseph, what's his name? Norman Vincent Peale was the preacher that he was involved with when he was a child. It was all about the law of positive thinking and manifestation and so on. You know, so yeah, I feel these are all signs of a kind of, you know, profound transformation that's happening to the nature of the psyche and the nature of our reality. If you get to, you know, it's very hard to define. It's easy for, you know, rationalists to become skeptical, you know, for sure.
Yeah, of course. I mean, and one of the things that I think that you mentioned, I have a bookshelf episode about your book, your first book, Breaking Open the Head, this week that we talked a little bit about. That idea of shadow material and the kind of like darkness that's kind of lurking in the psychology of the human mind. It's, you know, something that I think a lot of people talk about, including Freud, but the way of it, the way that it kind of like pops out, I think, you know, when you see different archetypal evils coming back again and again, I mean, when I hear a whole bunch of Americans, thousands of them chanting, you know, build a wall or send her back and all that kind of stuff that's happening right now, it feels like that's just part of that shadow material that just keeps coming back if we're not really looking at it.
Yeah, I mean, there's you know, a number of different ways to look at what's happening. I mean, my trajectory as a writer was, you know, as you mentioned, Breaking Open the Head on Psychedelic Shamanism was my first book. And when I started the research for that, I was a scientific materialist, but I was sort of having this existential crisis and this kind of spiritual yearning. And I went through a number of initiations. I went to Africa to go through an Iboga initiation with the Bwiti and visited a tribe in the Amazon to work with ayahuasca and explored a lot of, you know, different psychedelic substances, visionary plants and chemicals, and had so many experiences that basically transformed my belief system, you know, psychic phenomena, and all sorts, that ultimately I shifted from the Freudian to the Jungian kind of worldview, or the shamanic worldview. And that led me to the second book, 2012, The Return of Quetzalcoatl, which was looking at all these different prophecies of indigenous cultures. Many of them talk about this time as a kind of threshold of epochal transformation. And in the new essay, I talk about a Nahuatl shaman or sorcerer, or Sergio Magana, who wrote a book called The Age of the Sixth Sun, where he basically talks about how the Nahuatl or the Aztec people see the time between 2012, which was the end of the Long Count Mayan calendar, and 2021 as this kind of transition from the fifth sun, which was a sun of light, to the sixth sun, which is a sun of darkness. And essentially during the period of a sun of light, the things that are most prevalent are, kind of like science, rationality, waking, daylight consciousness. And as we move into a sun of darkness, it's going back more towards the psyche and the dream world. And reality becomes a little bit more like a waking or a lucid dream.
And that makes sense. Then the UFOs are here. That makes sense. You know, in that kind of cosmology, that idea that all the world is becoming more dreamlike. I think a lot of people out there would identify with that. And I think it's not just Trump, right? It's like a kind of a larger kind of. It might have something to do with the internet and the kind of way that we have intervened on a reality with technology now. But either way, yeah, I think you're right. That idea that that reality is more dreamy, certainly seems like that resonates with me.
Yeah. I mean, today I was reading a lot about the trickster.
Yeah.
And reading some excerpts from this incredible book by George Hansen called The Trickster and the Paranormal. And, he sort of points out how, like, we've done a huge amount of effort, over the last hundreds of years to, kind of inscribe this kind of rationality and these kind of structures, social structures. And the problem is that as we've attempted to banish the trickster, to the margins, I mean, the trickster is this sort of mythological figure who disrupts order and kind of like, acts in this, subtle domains and so on. So it feels like, we went too far in sort of creating these rationalized structures, and in a way now we're being sort of assaulted by the trickster, in all these different areas.
Would you call Trump a trickster?
I think he's definitely, a trickster archetype. I mean, some people talk about him as like Loki or like, the Lord of Misrule. Just think about how he's subverted all of our categories of like, what, an authority figure is or a presidential figure. I mean, if Obama wore like a beige tie or something, he would be decried by the media.
That's right.
But Trump can, be totally corrupt and, have sex with porn stars and, all this other stuff. And nothing seems able to affect him, or whatever. So it's like we've stepped into a totally different socio-political construct.
Yeah, and I know you do too, a lot about the 1960s and 70s counterculture. And it seems like that was a moment where the trickster thing was, the energy was on the left. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like the trickster energy was towards kind of like creating a more equitable society. And like, I have this book sitting here, somewhere in my room called The Movement Towards a New America, which is this giant collection of like underground newspapers and radical posters and stuff like that. And it's just like incredible to see how many people were engaged with, I don't know, esoteric thinking, if you want to put it that way, in the 60s. Yeah. And now, you know, I don't know how you feel about this, but, you know, the, we've seen a kind of rise of this kind of like intellectual dark web and all that kind of stuff. With different figures on it, you know, whether it be on Joe Rogan, Jordan Peterson, Sam Harris, there's a whole bunch of them that almost are like taking that Jungian trickster thing in a different direction and taking it towards like what we call the alt-right or whatever. I don't know. It feels like you're a part of something that's in a different area when we're thinking about that kind of stuff.
Yeah, thank you. No, I hear you. And I think that's, yeah, that's you know, and then I also think that some of this, I mentioned that I wrote this book 2012, and then I got kind of stymied and stuck for a while because I was, you know, the 2012 book was sort of on the occult or psychic aspects.
I was worried about you reading that book, dude, because I really follow your stuff. And reading out of 2012, I was thinking, you know, you're really pushing yourself, like you like really pushing yourself to the edge of trying to, you know, kind of solve something that might be unsolvable. Yeah, and I wondered how those years how those years went for you.
Well, then I really turned my attention to try to figure out. You know, I mean, particularly, I mean, a lot of my work generated from kind of becoming aware of the severity of the ecological crisis that we're facing.
Yeah, yeah.
Which, you know, was even a theme in Breaking Open the Head. And then in, 2012, I even talked about the danger of the methane from the Arctic and so on. So then I spent sort of 10 years where I started a company and a nonprofit, which was trying to build a larger movement for like a different paradigm. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I was also trying to write a book, which finally came out a couple of years ago, called How Soon Is Now, which was an effort to think about, you know, the alternative paradigm. The thesis of that book is that the ecological crisis is something like a collective initiation or rite of passage for humanity that is going to force us to move from an adolescent state of being to a mature and adult state of being. And to do that, we have to address, you know, the fatal flaws in our social systems, our political and economic systems, the way we're using technologies, you know, the functioning of corporations and so on. So then the book, you know, sought to offer the types of changes that would have to happen in all of those areas.
And it's beyond a communist manifesto, right? I mean, it's kind of like an engagement with who we are, right? And kind of taking that seriously. And I know the communist manifesto of a lot of Marxists are going to say Marx does that, and especially his Marx's early stuff is very, you know, philosophical. But either way, the idea that I don't know, the idea that we have to come to terms with who we are as beings, and that part of it kind of being forced by an ecological catastrophe is terrifying. I mean, we've seen a little bit of that already, and just in the years since you've written Breaking Open the Head, which I for me was like the book that tipped me off to the ecological catastrophe as this kind of human crisis. But either way, you know, we've seen in the years since we've seen that. I mean, there are the only people that are around that are kind of denying that are kind of intensely ideological people.
Yeah.
The climate thing is here. And I think that, I don't know, the 2012 moment. Now, if we can talk about 2012 really quickly, because I think reading your stuff in 2004, 2005, 2006, I was super into 2012 as kind of like this transformational moment. And, you know, I also listened to tons of Terrence McKenna tapes and was into his kind of a time wave zero. And I was really convinced that 2012 was going to be this kind of like, I had this kind of adolescent idea myself of like what it might be. But instead 2012 came and passed, and I was kind of like in graduate school and very much paying attention to, you know, the rational world of politics and history. And I thought, well, 2012 came and went, and that was that. But now as time goes by, since 2012, it feels like, I don't know, it feels like it did happen in some way. It feels like we are in an intense transformative moment. In other words, it's almost like I'm returning to the 2012 idea, if that makes sense. Does that make sense to you? It's almost like in other words, I was disappointed that 2012 wasn't like 10,000 UFOs coming down to take us to hyperspace. Right. And instead, it's like, well, I think something more subtle and real is going on.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, that's why I was fascinated to read this book called The Age of the Sixth Sun, which talks about 2012 to 2021 as being the transition from kind of the one, you know, epoch next. And I heard that from a Mayan elder also. And, you know, it, yeah, in the 2012 book, I never said that like anything devastatingly.
No, I know.
Yeah.
You're not a prophetic figure in the sense of this is what's going to happen. And I think that's what's most appealing about you, honestly, to a person, that's a thoughtful person. Yeah.
Yeah. So I totally agree with you. I feel that, that extended moment of, it's almost like humanity is going on a, you know, psychedelic journey together at this point. And it's, you know, unfortunately it's almost like a collective bad acid trip, you know?
Well, speaking of psychedelics, I mean, that's what turned me on literally, you know, in terms of your book to the idea of taking the psychedelic experience seriously. I think I'd like taken mushrooms once when I read your book, and I thought it was kind of, you know, a silly experience that I didn't really know how to integrate. But then your book almost, you know, gave me permission to think about it seriously and then discover this whole world of people taking it seriously. But you know what's crazy is kind of like, I remember working at a restaurant here in Ventura, California, and talking about DMT with people and asking them, you know, do you know about this? Have you heard about DMT? And no one knew what it was. It was just kind of like a secret thing. And your book kind of really described it in such detail. And Rick Straussman was another person that had a book out at the time. But either way, DMT is everywhere now. I feel like people talk about it all the time. I've heard bartenders, you know, like frat boy bartenders in Vegas talking about their DMT trip. Did you anticipate that happening at all? And what do you think about the direction that's taken? Because it's like kind of a dream in some sense of like, okay, we're all doing DMT, we're all doing psychedelics, but it seems like set and setting, and the culture has to be there to surround it.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's many levels to, you know, unpack in the whole phenomenon. I mean, in general, you know, yeah, I mean, I think it is an important phenomenon that like somehow, you know, we're, you know, more able to kind of access these realms of the psyche, you know, without it being sort of disintegrative. I mean, one of the things I argued in Breaking Open the Head is that, you know, the psychedelic revolution didn't only end, you know, because society turned against it, you know, and illegalized it. Mm-hmm. It's also like we really weren't ready for it. So you even had people like, you know, John Lennon talking about how he did so much LSD that it destroyed his ego, and it took him like years to, you know, piece it back together.
Right.
You know, so, you know, we didn't really have elders at that point. So people would just, you know, get sort of smashed up, like, you know, Altamont, you know, the crowd of like Altamont or whatever. So now it's coming back into the culture, you know, in a more integrated way. Mm. And yes, and people, you know, many people are still, you know, investigating it, you know, kind of personal ways or hedonistic ways. But the amount of scientific research and discovery that's happening of really how to use, you know, these tools as healers, you know, is amazing. I mean, it's just a much more, it seems like it's a much more grounded, you know, in some pockets of society, you know, the 60s are happening again right now, and they're happening in more
ways than one, I think.
Yeah.
In the way people are politically organizing, et cetera.
Yeah. So, yeah, so that's, you know, what we're learning about MDMA for post-traumatic stress disorder, or the psilocybin trials for depression, which I just learned about this weekend, or the Imperial College studying the, you know, being able to do brain scans of people on high dose LSD and psilocybin DMT. So you can actually see how these compounds, you know, activate different dormant aspects of the brain and have these aspects of the brain interconnect in ways that don't happen, you know, which supports the anecdotal evidence that they're really profound tools for creativity and innovative problem solving and so on. So yeah, the whole puzzle is coming together now. And, you know, I don't think that the psychedelic genie is going to be put back in the bottle. I think we're going to see a more and more profound transformation of society in a positive direction because of it. But that doesn't mean there's not, you know, going to be some harm and some individual crises and catastrophes. But actually the new book, the Occult Control System is a short essay that, you know, I just, you know, popped into the world. But I've been working for a couple of years on a new book with a co-author, Sophia Rocklin. Mm-hmm. And that book is about the global spread of ayahuasca.
Nice.
And it's coming out in September from Watkins. That book is called When Plants Dream. It looks at ayahuasca in the context of this whole global psychedelic renaissance that's happening.
When Plants Dream, such an evocative title. It reminds me of some of the experiments you covered in Breaking Open the Head. I don't know if you remember, but you talked about one where, you know, they were basically hooking up, you know, different kinds of sensors to plants and could finding out things that, you know, plants, you know, had a level of perception of human intention that's kind of unbelievable. And anyone who's anyone who I think has like tripped in a forest gets that, you know, gets that idea of the, you know, that Shel Silverstein poem that's very, you know, of the giving tree, which is a very childlike kind of depiction of that idea, right? That the trees know. I was just since moving to Southern California, Daniel, I see a lot more. I see a lot more like hippie stuff and a lot more like Volkswagen vans. I saw one yesterday that said, I had an old bumper sticker on it. Just said, the trees are the answer. And it felt like that one, you could put that on the back of your book.
Yeah. I think that was from The Secret Life of Plants, which was really an amazing, book with incredible information in it. Yeah. I mean, you know, that's, I mean, When Plants Dream, we talk about, you know, different ayahuasca traditions, but one of them that comes up a lot is the Shipibo from Peru, which is, you know, maybe the most, advanced, development in the ayahuasca shamanism. And for them, ayahuasca is just kind of like, the key that opens the door to the whole universe of, master plants that, you could work with and do dietas with, and you can use them for different reasons. Like some are for opening the heart, or some are for creativity, or I think there's a really very, very vast dimension of exploration and discovery to be had in that whole area, which is, you know, very, very exciting for humanity's future, I think.
And it's, I mean, is it in America more? I mean, when I was in New York for years, you know, I heard rumors of people going to apartments and drinking ayahuasca in different contexts in New York City and throughout the U.S. Is it more of something that's happening here?
It's happening. I mean, it's actually really becoming like a global phenomenon. I mean,
yeah,
it's, you know, Taiwan and South Africa. And
I didn't realize those places. So it's spread beyond the kind of
Tokyo.
I still have this vision of, you know, you write about the different, like, you know, early like Western modernist artists and authors who traveled to South America. And you know, you have that kind of quite classic vision of like, I don't know, almost like a white imperial thing a little bit of like going into an indigenous tribe and kind of like trying to grab their knowledge, you know, and that idea, it seems like has evolved a little bit. It's not quite that anymore.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, we're still in a transitional, period. We may be in, you know, different types of transitions, you know, for the foreseeable future.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, there's still, you know, it's still an issue that a lot of, you know, Westerners go down to South America, and on the one hand, they kind of pull the you know, local shamans out of their context, and suddenly, you know, their shamans become like, you know, globetrotting, you know, shamans, but they're actually they were the glue that, you know, healed the whole community, and when the community loses that, it's really not very nice. And then there's also now you know, some scarcity issues around ayahuasca. In fact, Sophia, who is my co-author on When Plants Dream, is coordinating a program with a nonprofit in Peru to sustainably grow and harvest ayahuasca for the benefit of local indigenous communities. Because the ayahuasca is growing scarce really quickly, as so many Westerners go down there, you know, seeking it. And, you know, even though it can grow pretty robustly, it's a vine, it can grow in Florida, it can grow in Hawaii and so on, it takes like 7 to 10 years to reach maturity or something like that. So
it's such a funny image to me, and I mean, funny is like maybe the wrong word, but of kind of like these hard-headed Westerners desperately seeking some sort of spiritual experience, right? And like looking all over the world for it. Why do you think that? Why is it? And I think about, like, I've heard a few different people, you know, in the U.S. talk about, I don't know, the fact that we need our own traditions. We don't need to be taking, you know, the kind of like shamanistic traditions from another tribe. We need to be making our own shamans, right, in the United States. We wonder what that would even look like. But I wonder if you had something to say about why is it that Americans are so hard-headed. Why has that kind of spirituality and that kind of direct spirituality not really taken root in the United States? Why are we all so desperate for this experience?
Well, I mean, as I've written about, like, the European, the Anglo-European worlds, as it turned away from kind of the direct kind of mystical experience, it's more like a, you know, priest-mediated form of religion. You know, that then led to the rise of, you know, scientific, you know, knowledge and so on. But, you know, there grew to be a kind of hatred of the older forms of consciousness, the more intuition, you know, visionary, you know, maybe feminine in some ways, mm-hmm. orientation. And so then you have like the Inquisition, where, you know, Europe and England, you know, actively sought out the holders of ancient plant knowledge and you know, psychic awareness, and, you know, basically killed them, you know, burned them at the stake.
Right.
So you remove that whole layer of people who were more kind of in touch to these other dimensions. And, you know, that still really marks our society. Like, you know, so, and then we developed this whole scientific rationalism. So people mostly live in a very materialist mindset and so on. They're, you know, they don't believe that it's even possible to, you know, break through that, you know, until they go through such a deep crisis that they have no choice but to search for it.
You know, I'm thinking about that there maybe was one American shaman that we think of the most when we think of psychedelics is Timothy Leary. And he reminds me of that, the you know, what you're talking about in terms of the 60s being like, maybe they weren't quite ready, you know, to take it on entirely. Leary's a really important figure, but one that's also like super problematic for a million different reasons. But either way, it feels like, in other words, it feels like an adolescent first step, and maybe we're in the next one.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, Leary, I think, was like 40 years old before he ever took a psychedelic. He
was,
you know, long-term alcoholic who, you know, cheated on his, you know, wives and so on. You know, kind of, you know, a very charismatic, you know, somewhat morally questionable kind of guy of his time. And, you know, he suddenly became the go-to guy for the society around this stuff, but he'd really only had, like, you know, at that point, 2 or 3 years of experience. Mm. And, you know, and we also know now that, you know, not all the effects that psychedelics have are good. They can inflate the ego, you know, they can lead to, like, you know, megalomania. You know, there's some evidence that the CIA was actually pushing psychedelics on the counterculture in the late 60s, early 70s.
You know, knowing about that, yeah.
So, I mean, you know, we're getting more, you know, cognizant of all the different levels of this. And it's just a work in process.
Know? It's interesting. I mean, I follow a lot of follow a lot of like left wing people, radical people. I mean, there's a subset of the radical left in the United States that are very interested in psychedelics and that very much kind of see that. But it's always, you know, it's funny is that you saw. It's something that I love about your work is you're always kind of like, you come from like, you know, a very kind of like New York literary kind of milieu, you know, a very like rational, scientific, you know, view of the world. But like, you know, that idea that stuff is hard to kind of bring on is something that a lot of people need to get over. But either way, I feel like a lot of those when you're that type of person, you're a person that's rational and comes from that and still wants to in some ways kind of like, I don't know, integrate it and make sense of it. It can be very hard to like hang around with psychedelic people because there's a lot of like kooks out there, and it's a kooky kind of like environment. I think and it's hard to talk about that without being pejorative because I don't want to like shit on people, but like I've been in some psychedelic circles where I'm like, wow, I'm like lost here, right? And I don't know if I trust these people. And there's like kind of like, I don't know, that trickster element. I think that's part of maybe what makes it hard to kind of see a clear way forward, because once you start getting in those circles, you're in those circles, if that makes sense.
Yeah, well, I mean, I just also keep seeing like a lot of evolution in the psychedelic community, a lot of you know, more responsibility and kind of, you know, more, you know, social community constructs. Like now there's this whole thing called the Psychedelic Society in Europe. And in the US too.
Haven't heard of it.
Oh yeah?
No, I haven't heard of it. What is it?
Yeah, well, it's like a, you know, decentralized, self-organizing, movement to create, you know, centers, you know, probably mainly for, you know, younger people in their 20s and 30s, but it's not age, separated, where people are coming together to, you know, discuss, the values of these experiences and the dangers of them and get more knowledge about it. You know, so knowledge is actually spreading really rapidly through a number of different currents.
Do you think you've written a ton over the years about Burning Man. Do you think Burning Man has outlasted its usefulness and we need to like evolve to another model of kind of like coming together shamanistically in America? Because that's probably the biggest example of like thousands of people getting together and doing these kinds of drugs. And it definitely caught my attention coming from the West Coast. I never went out to Black Rock, but I always was intrigued by it. Eventually, I realized I couldn't afford to go to Burning Man, which kind of tipped me off to some of the political elements of it. But either way, do you think is that a model that you think like whenever we think of the Matrix movies turn like they kind of like whenever they imagine like a kind of like Bacchanalian coming together, it always has that kind of like dancey, ravey thing going on. But it feels like Burning Man. I don't know if you could talk a little bit about Burning Man, because it feels like that's a really important thing, but also maybe something that feels dated.
That's interesting. Well, yeah, I've been involved with Burning Man for a long time, and definitely, feel that it was like, incredible gift when I first discovered it. Mm-hmm. I wrote about it. The first time I went there, I wrote about it for Rolling Stone. So I got to talk to all the people who started it, all the brilliant artists, so on behind it.
Your articles are some of the, for people that want to go back, your articles, especially the early years of Burning Man, are some of the best kind of anthropological takes on what was going on there. And I think a lot of people that have never been there and don't really have they have maybe a kind of culturally stereotypical idea of what's there. Go back and read Daniel's early stuff in Rolling Stone, etc., because it's really great. And Burning Man has evolved, though, I guess.
Yeah. So, I think that, originally, they discovered it, it was a bunch of like chaos magicians and, neo-shamans and so on. And artists went out there and they discovered this like incredible blank canvas. And the idea was this opportunity for, human creativity to really, explore, in all these different ways. But, what invariably happens or tends to happen over time is, culture forms. I mean, actually, like Terence McKenna, used to say that culture is our enemy. Because, once a culture forms, then people conform to that culture. And so they're not, really, really, exploring their originality and their creativity. So now, it used to be that cell phones didn't work out there. Now cell phones work, people are taking a lot of selfies, and basically, people have kind of learned how to be at Burning Man. And it's also attracted a lot more successful mainstream people. And, at this point it's, I still go because, there are people who have open minds who are, exploring. And there's also, incredibly influential and powerful people there who are the kind of people you want to speak about.
That's interesting.
If you're interested in the ecological crisis.
Isn't that kind of amazing when you think about that? You're, writing about Burning Man early on, you're like, this is like, this is some edge stuff. These are like people that are like weirdos in San Francisco. They're like doing some drugs and going out and creating this kind of like, anarchist carnival in the desert, apart from everything else. But like to hear you say that, like powerful people go there right now.
Well, it was true. I mean, even the first year that I went, I met all these people who were like, project developers, project managers at Microsoft, and so on.
Silicon Valley is all over Burning Man, right?
Yeah, but now it's also kind of like the wealthy people from Ibiza. The art cars have become like the new yachts. People put hundreds of thousands of dollars into building these incredible vehicles, and there's a lot of show off, ostentatiousness, and it isn't really it sort of had this we're all in this together vibe before, which was actually very sweet, and now it feels more socially stratified, and it's kind of become more like a another version of mainstream reality. But having said that, I think one of the very interesting things about our time that we see in, Burning Man or movements like Occupy or even in something like TED or Extinction Rebellion is the way that you can, you know, template a set of ideas or principles, and then people can create their own, you know, version of that structure, like anywhere in the world. So, you know, the Burning Man's 10 principles are still really, really beautiful. Like, leave no trace, you know, make sure you take care of all your own waste, and there's no observers. Everybody has to is a participant. You know, gift economy, no money use. Everybody has to, you know, exchange differently with their charm or things that they make themselves, and so on. Mm-hmm. So all of that stuff is really profound and does create like a new cultural milieu. And yeah, so you know, even people who are going now, when it's a little bit more attenuated and a little bit more cliched in a way, they're still getting the benefit of that cultural paradigm.
Yeah, I encourage people to go read those 10 principles, because I agree. I think those ten like foundational principles of Burning Man could be the template for you know, values of a new society that I think are important. I wondered if you could talk a little bit before we go about technology, because Terrence McKenna is someone I think probably influenced both of us in terms of these kinds of ideas. And people that don't know Terrence McKenna's thoughts, go check them out. They're all over the place now. I feel like it's amazing actually to like flip through Instagram and see memes with Terrence McKenna in them, offering DMT and like cartoons all over them. And it really kind of like makes me think that God, Terrence really was onto a lot. But he was really optimistic about technology. He felt like technology was kind of like an answer for us. But it feels like, I don't know how you feel about that, but because it feels like moving forward, and he didn't live long enough to see really the internet become, you know, social media and all the stuff that it is now. But he predicted it. I mean, he literally talked about stuff that sounds like Facebook and Twitter. But either way, he kind of had this idea that we would find the others, right? That it would allow people to connect and form communities and bonds that they hadn't before. And I think that's true, but it's also, you know, seems like it's unleashed some sort of like fascist hell on the earth too. And I wonder if that's something that you think about in terms of McKenna and technology and kind of the direction we're going.
Yeah. Well, once again, you know, as I was mentioning earlier, this idea of the trickster.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, we had a lot of, you know, we invested a lot of faith as a society that technology was going to be this liberating force. And now we see this sort of trickster dimension where it's actually, you know, has a lot of darkness there and even kind of exacerbates kind of like shadow sides of the psyche. And that's also, you know, seems to be part of this sort of kind of murky dreamlike scenario that we're moving into. Now there's like fake news and you know, disinformation rampant and QAnon and deep fake, you know. So now essentially in the future, you know, it's going to be extremely difficult to trust, you know, any piece of video or audio, because you could have a totally realistic video of, you know, Obama saying that, like, he likes to eat, you know, white babies for breakfast.
Mm-hmm. And, or UFOs, you know, right? That's another element of it.
Exactly.
So, when I see videos, you know, and especially if we see momentous stuff, which I think that the appeal of your work, Daniel, to be honest, is that you kind of give a sense that we are in a momentous times and we will see tremendous things in our lifetime. And I think a lot of us have that sense even just intuitively. But even if we do see incredible stuff, you know, like, you know, I feel like I'm going to be somewhere walking around and someone's going to buzz my phone and say, did you look on Facebook or look on Twitter, check the news and see some video, and I'm not going to know if I can even trust that video anymore. And I think that's part of the kind of weird, that seems like there's a lesson there too. Like, it's almost like a don't trust your eyes kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and it's possible to imagine how we could deal with some of that. Like, for instance, you know, through blockchain, we could create like trust networks. So you'd be able to verify content through people you trust, people they trust, you know, because of like the, you know, the fact that we're all only 7 degrees of separation away from each other or whatever. But it's gonna continue to get very, very murky, and it's gonna be a very dark time for a lot of people who don't have a lot of resources because, you know, the climate crisis and drought and you know, all this stuff is going to hit the weaker, you know, the poorer half of the population much harder.
Already is, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's, and it's just beginning, really.
Right. So, right. I mean, it feels like all the refugee immigration stuff is like a reaction to, in part, the idea that people are moving around the globe at a rate that they never have for a long, long time.
Right. I think
they're like 65, right. 70 million people
65 yeah. million refugees.
Yeah. I mean,
right. And that's also like, and then we can see that that's actually directly connected to the rise of the right wing because, you know, there's kind of like in the 30s when people felt that, they needed like Lebensraum, like living room, like there wasn't enough room for people, overpopulation. Mm. I think there's this felt, you know, growing felt sense and anxiety that, we're beginning to run short on resources. Climate change is dissolving, pressuring borders or dissolving borders. And kind of the first response to that is to regress back to kind of right-wing authoritarianism. But that's not going to do the job either. So actually, we're going to ultimately need to move in a different direction if we're going to survive as a species. Mm. And that is what I spent like 10 years like trying to like understand and outline, in How Soon Is Now. And but I do see that potential, even with some of what Extinction Rebellion is beginning to put forward, which is kind of like, local organizing, communities, bioregional models of organizing, maybe the nation state becomes less tenable as kind of the node of organization and things devolve back more to the local level.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like we're seeing a national kind of nationalist explosion right now, similar to, something in the lead up that we've seen in the lead up to world wars in the 20th century. And that part of it is like, I don't know, you wrote your first book in the shadow literally of 9/11, right? And like we talk a lot about on this show because that's been the experience of our lifetimes of kind of like since September 11th that kind of like brought that authoritarian shadow out, right? And we felt it very powerfully in the Bush regime. It's kind of interesting because people are freaking out about Trump right now, but if you just go back and read even just your stuff or a million other people, like the George W. Bush regime was horrifying, and it felt like a certain kind of that energy, that right-wing energy that you describe, had been accelerated and released at that moment and is now accelerating even further. I don't know what to do about that, but I just mention it in the sense of like, I don't know, that there's an epic battle, it seems, moving forward. And I wonder if it has to be a battle, but either way, the shadow material is in control right now, and or at least seems in control, and that part of it's really disturbing.
I see that, but then I also do see a lot of kind of evolution happening, people becoming more aware, mm-hmm. and whether that's through psychedelics or through like, tantra or like political organizing or ecological activism. In a way, for many years I was so focused on this ecological crisis and trying to figure out like what would be a sort of, possible solution. To a certain extent, I've kind of surrendered that I think maybe we're not going to have a solution, and maybe things are just going to kind of, disintegrate on some level. But even that might be part of a more occult or esoteric reality. Like, in my work, I've talked a lot about like occult philosophers like Rudolf Steiner,
yes,
and their understanding of like, kind of like our, spiritual evolution into the future. I don't know. I mean,
it's been a while since I've taken psychedelics, but the last time I took acid and was maybe like 8 years ago, and the message I got was a common one, which is, and I know this resonates with you probably because you've written about it, but this idea that like, so you often get this sense on psychedelics that like certain psychedelics that all is happening according to plan. Or the sense that like don't worry about it. It's all just happening, and it's happening now, right? And it's like it has something to do with the way we perceive time, and there's a lot of trippy ways to think about that. But either way, the sense that don't worry about it. It's all kind of happening is a really kind of it's a weird idea, and one that I'm not trying to kind of be nihilistic about it, but I do get that message.
Yeah, I mean. Right. But that's also, you know, like the tantric ideas like samsara is nirvana, right? So on some level, you know, there's only perfection. This is just like a little ephemeral, you know, bubble that, that happened to emerge in the void, you know. But you know, it may also be that, you know, the suppressions and the you know, all the negative aspects are, you know, the what's necessary to force, you know, a much more positive movement of transformation, that we have to just go through the sort of the abyss phase before we get somewhere else.
It,
you know,
it might hurt a little, but that there's growth in, no pain, no gain is what you're saying.
Yeah, something like that.
Daniel, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. We should have you on again as the story unfolds.
That sounds great. But I would definitely encourage your audience to check out my work. What else am I supposed to do? I'm a writer. But Breaking Open the Head is my first book, 2012, The Shrine of Quetzalcoatl, which is hardly read now, but I feel is like actually super relevant.
I pick it up all the time, dude. And just cracking into little pieces of it. I'll do a bookshelf episode on that one too, because it was when it came out, I was like, wow, Daniel is really pushing himself with this. But now as time goes by past the 2012 moment, I feel more and more that stuff is we need to return to.
Yeah. And then there's How Soon Is Now, which is more the effort to kind of put all the ducks in the row of what the type of changes we would have to make systemically. And then this new little essay book, the Occult Control System, about aliens abductions and UFOs. And then coming out in September is When Plants Dream, which is a overview of the global phenomenon of ayahuasca. It really covers it from all different angles: the legal aspect, the healing aspect, the personal transformation aspect, the origins of the medicine, like kind of everything we know about it in one pretty short book.
Very exciting. Thank you so much for joining us. And again, like the kind of like the idea of a lot of people on this show are, you know, leftists and Marxists, and I wanted to talk to you and get more of this stuff about kind of like, a lot of stuff is going to happen and surround us in our lives, but paying attention to your head is part of it, and getting that part of it together is something that can be part of a larger kind of social and political movement.
Right on. Well, cool. Thanks very much. They were great questions, and I appreciated the dialogue.
Sure. Talk to you soon. Yeah. Take care. Okay, I want to give a big thank you to my guest, Daniel Pinchbeck. Always fun to talk to him. Always fun to catch up with his take on things. And again, he's got lots of work out there. But if you want to go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap, I've got a bonus episode up this week that talks about his first book, 2003's Breaking Open the Head, which I think is a great starting point with his work and with the ideas that he's wrestling with. So thanks so much for listening to the program. We will talk to you again very soon. Take care. See ya.